Hello guys, welcome back to my channel. Hey, it's me Swastika, and today we would be going over the current affairs for July 10, 2020 from the newspaper The Hindu, as we always do. So before we begin, I'll tell you a little about myself. I've done my Master's in Political Science from Jawaharlal Nehru University. I've done my BA Honours in Political Science from Delhi University. And in the case that you like my content, please press subscribe button. Subscribe to my YouTube channel. It's the red button at the bottom of the screen. So today we, in the editorial page, there is an article on how the US is withdrawing from WHO. So while we discuss this, you would also discuss a little about what WHO is essentially. The next article that I found relevant is on digital freedom and on the imposition and national security. So this is in the context of 59 Chinese apps, including TikTok, UC browser being banned by the Indian government. And the next was a small article on Malabar exercises. So we will discuss what exactly is it. The next news is concerned with the extension of Atmanirbhar package till August 31st. So this is in the short news. So without further ado, let's begin. So the US is basically accusing the WHO of being extremely China-centric in its policies. By doing so, Donald Trump is just trying to ignore his mismanagement of the pandemic crisis, the fact that he started off late. But the USA and Donald Trump are basically trying to shift in the blame on WHO by saying that it is not independent from China and is constantly supporting China. Because of this, US is withdrawing from WHO, and this withdrawal from WHO is going to be a significant blow because it is said to lose around $450 million from doing so. So this is in fact not a good move, but then WHO is under fire for A, being China centric, and B, not being able to impart correct information at the right point of time. Its declaration of the coronavirus being a pandemic came very late when it had basically spread, but that does not excuse the USA from grossly mismanaging the crisis. The 2015 revision of the International Health Regulations made it mandatory for countries to notify WHO of all events that may constitute a public health emergency and to respond to such requests of verifications of information regarding such events. So in 2005, the International Health Regulations were revised, right? So obviously, USA being one of the biggest donors to WHO was a part of this meeting, and they made it mandatory for countries to notify WHO of all events that may constitute a public health emergency. Yet, WHO has limited power to ensure the compliance of the states. So while WHO is in a position to declare a state of emergency, which it did, though considerably late, it has limited power to ensure the compliance of states. WHO cannot force the state into compliance. So the USA was majorly involved in the 2005 International Health Regulation, but will have no role to play in strengthening the WHO now. So this is not really good for USA because WHO still remains a major organ. So USA was majorly involved in 2005 IHR, but with its departure, it will no longer have any role to play. We'll lose a seat at the table to determine the virus strain used for developing influenza vaccines and have no access to influenza virus samples. So these two are basically the consequences of US departure. One is that USA no longer has a role to play in strengthening the WHO now, and secondly, that it loses a seat at the table to determine the virus strain used for developing influenza vaccines and will have no access to new influenza virus. So this is about WHO, basic information. So WHO was founded in 1948 with a specialized agency of the United Nations with a broad mandate to act as a coordinating authority on international health issues. The main decision body at WHO is the annual World Health Assembly, attended by all the member states. This, there is also an executive board comprising technically qualified persons from 34 countries, elected based on geographic representation from across the globe. So the consequences of the US decision, politicization of the pandemic, reduces WHO's ability to coordinate the fight against pandemic in coming months. WHO's significance will decline in the long run if the shortfall in funding is not addressed. Impacts the public health prospects of Africa. Half of all spending of WHO was in Africa. Impacts health programs of WHO. A quarter of WHO budget went into polio eradication, 12% on access to healthcare, and 5% on outbreak prevention and control. It provides further scope for China to increase its funding and to influence WHO. So obviously, if the US is withdrawing, China is going to start pumping in money to WHO. So WHO now has to do what? If it wasn't China-centric in the past, it would increasingly become China-centric, therefore increasing the power of China. Signals US intention of retreating from global affairs, thus creating a vacuum in global leadership roles. So if USA departs from this, it will obviously create a vacuum, because USA would no longer be considered the global leader. So the next article, it was basically the op-ed, and two people have discussed it. One is Argya Sen Gupta, who is the research director at the Vidhi Center for Legal Policy, and Raman Chima, who is the Asia Policy Director at HS Now. So they have basically talked about the debate that is going on regarding the ban of 59 Chinese apps. So the debate is between national security and digital rights. So basically, by banning 59 apps, India has signaled towards a protectionist policy, and they have done so in the name of national security. But thus doing so curtail the digital rights of digital rights that individuals enjoy in a democracy? That is a big question. So before we move on in this, I'm just going to discuss the important sections that have been invoked to sort of ban the apps. One is Section 69A of the Information Technology Act. This has been used to ban 59 Chinese apps. It is not a new power that the government is commanding, but a national security emergency. It must only be used for a genuine reason. So this 69A is basically a censorship power which comes under the Information Technology Act. Right, and there are two ways of evoking it. The first is you do it under a normal circumstance. The second is that you evoke this act during an emergency. So what India is doing right now is that we have done an emergency blocking of apps instead of a normal procedure. And we have done this on the ground of national security. So, India is a signatory of International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, as well as Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So, basic understanding is that internet regulation has to respect human rights. So, it is not right on the part of the government so as to just ban 59 apps, because it gives China a moral upper hand. And it's not right because it curtails the digital freedom and the digital rights that individuals in a democracy would otherwise enjoy. And because they have done this under an emergency blocking, so this means that the Chinese apps have to now make a case if they want to still if they want to create a market in India. So first they have to go to the courts, and then they have to request, and then they have to explain to India why they would want to come to the Indian market. So this is basically the debate on it. We have to remember that Section 69A was imposed. So in the previous slide, we talked about the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and United Universal Declaration for Human Rights. So what are these two things? So Universal Declaration of Human Rights is a historical document that was adopted by the United Nations General Assembly at its third session on December 10, 1948. as Resolution 2019 at the Palais de Chaillot in Paris, France. So UDHR will have 1948, 10th December, Palais de Chaillot in Paris, France, hua tha. So guys, you have to sort of remember this because this is important. Like UDHR has always been in the limelight and in media attention, and sometimes they just ask you questions on its location. So the location is Paris de Chaillot in Paris, France. And I remember this one paper I gave, and they actually asked me where it was established. So the date is 1948, 10th December. Just try to remember this. The declaration consists of 30 articles affirming an individual's rights, which although are not legally binding themselves, have been elaborated in subsequent international treaties, economic transfers, regional human rights instruments, national constitutions, and others. So UDHR is not legally binding, but obviously if you are a signatory, you can't just grossly and inappropriately not listen to this. The declaration was the first step in the process of formulating the International Bill of Human Rights, which was completed in 1966 and came into force in 1976 after a sufficient number of countries had ratified them. Secondly, the International Court, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, is a multilateral treaty adopted by the United Nations General Assembly on 16th December 1966. It commits its parties to respect civil and political rights of individuals, including right to life, freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, and due process and a free trial. So it is a part of the International Bill of Human Rights along with the International Covenant on Economic, Social, Cultural Rights and the UDHR, which is this one. Right. So the ICCPR is monitored by the United Nations Human Rights Committee and its headquarters are in New York City. So this is just some of the basic information. UDHR is super important. Please like remember the information. And so the next thing in short news today, we see that Australia has again extended requests and they are saying that please put us in Malabar exercises as well. So India basically conducts Malabar exercises with Japan and USA. So if this is India, this is USA, this is Japan, then this is Australia. So right now there is just the three of us. If Australia also joins, it will become a coordinator, and so Australia is saying let's become a coordinator and let's perform these Malabar exercises. So the Malabar exercises is basically a bilateral Navy exercise between India and USA. So it began in 1992. So initially there was India and there was USA. There was just the two of us. And Japan also joined, it became a triangle. Now Australia is saying I want to join so it will become a coordinator. But India is not accepting the Australian request. In more 2018 and 19, India rejected. And Japan was basically included in 2015. So just try to remember this. Next in short news today, we would be discussing. So this has again been coming in news for the last 2 weeks, which basically this is between the two schemes. One is Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, and the second scheme is the Atmanirbhar Bharat package. So the basic difference between the two schemes is that the Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana basically caters to people who have a ration card, and it only benefits those people, right? But this other, the Atmanirbhar Bharat package, caters to people who don't have ration card. So it's not exclusionary, it tries to include both migrant workers, non-migrant workers, and it does not exclude people who don't have the ration card. So Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana has recently been extended by the Narendra Modi government till November end. Similarly, Atmanirbhar Bharat package has also been extended till August 31 to provide free food range to workers without a ration card. So this package basically provides you with 5 kg food grain per person, 1 kg free whole gram per family distributed to migrant laborers and stranded and needy families who are not covered under the National Food Security Act. So this essentially is for people who are excluded from the NFSA. So 20 million tons of food grains have been earmarked for free distribution to Antyodaya Anna Yojana and priority household card holders up to November in the country. So this, as I have mentioned before, is a part of PMGKAY, Pradhanamantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. So in this, 11 million rice has been earmarked and 9 million wheat has been earmarked. So this is all for today, guys. If you like my content, then please press the subscribe button. That will be great of you. And thank you for listening to me and stay tuned for further updates.